Hello! Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by... You want fries with that?
What did I just come into?
There can be only one.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
I want to make a special shout out to a special person out there. A guy named Kleb Smith. He has actually drew us a excellent fan art of our previous episode, including me in drag, which you'll probably not see me on this podcast, but in picture form, you can check it out. What's up, pups? I'm Mike Mixtape, and welcome to another episode of Cinema Royale. Let's introduce to you the co-host, which you might know or might not know. First up, we got Matt Brunet, also known as Adamet.
It's Cinema Royale's Monster Madness! Wait, isn't that taken already?
Yes.
Oh, fudge. Crap. Redo! No, go on.
Yep, retcon.
Next up, we got the man in the middle on my side, James Sullivan, also known as Jaime Tude.
Tonight's podcast is brought to you by Revenge of the Burgermeister.
And last...
It's Jägermeister and burgers together, the best thing ever.
I got it. Thanks for explaining the joke.
Well, isn't that from Santa Claus is Coming to Town? You know that guy, I hate Christmas and I hate Kris Kringle.
Which one is that?
No, not mine. Wait, hold on. No, not mine.
Never mind. Last but not least, we've got Sylvie.
Hello, everyone. I vamped it up for the podcast, my vampire makeup.
Yes. Just
get in the spirit.
Spirits of vampires.
Okay, I was wondering about that getup.
Yes.
Nice.
Oh, then I already. Oh, then. Oh, I knew what I should have. What I started with.
So let's get
He's
this out
the
of the
tenor,
way.
He's got the tenor. I've got the soprano.
So, for those of you who don't know, we're recording on Monday, October 6th, which we were supposed to record yesterday, which is October 5th, which was Matt Brunet's 22nd birthday.
Yes!
So yeah. We took a holiday for it, that's why.
Yeah, we took a holiday.
Holy day, so...
I was pretty much busy. Like, I was actually on a film set, so...
Oh, wow.
Hey, yeah. Yeah, it was kind of like a birthday gift from my cousin. So, why not?
So
awesome.
So, yeah, if we had recorded yesterday, he wouldn't be here. But in honor of the recent birthday, he goes first. So, let's start off with the obvious film.
Wait, let me introduce this. Hold on. Now, originally, we technically did talk about it, and it was during the Adam Sandler episode. But, since that episode is now considered lost, might as well not let this go to waste and talk about it right here, because it seems perfect. I am talking, of course, of the 2012 Sony Pictures Animation's Hotel Transylvania. Now, for those of you watching, I know what you guys are thinking. Oh, no. Animat's going to talk about a Sony Pictures animated film. What is he going to do now? Now, hold on a second. James, what the fridge was that?
That's me moving like a Sony Pictures animation character.
No, James, you gotta hit yourself in the hammer a bit, then you can do that. That's how it works. Now, however, Before I do any of the criticism, I will say that there are some good things to talk about in Hotel Transylvania. Two things to be precise. Number one, yes, I will agree, it is a funny movie. There are some moments that they do have a lot of good comedic moments, mostly coming from Dracula and his pals and stuff. And that I would give credit to the director, Jenny Tartakovsky. He manages to bring his style of humor into the film, and there were some moments that actually did work, and a lot of memorable, funny moments. And another good thing I want to mention is that this is actually Adam Sandler's better performances. I mean, if you compare it to, like, plenty of others, like, you know, when he tries to be the annoying goofball, you know, and all that stuff, in here, he's actually nothing like that. He's calm, you know, he's caring, he's lovable and stuff like that. And, and an interesting thing is that, like, he doesn't go, like, full out on the Dracula thing. Funny enough, like, he's just being the calm and caring father. Like, they even did a joke of that where he, like, suddenly he's just looking outside going, I don't go, blah, 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 blah. But this is not to say that this all makes a great film. Not really. Here are some of my problems, however. Number one, it is constructed way too much as a TV show. And when you think about the concept of Hotel Transylvania and stuff like that, you'd think that would make an amazing TV series. As a movie, not so much, because, like, there are so many elements from a TV show where it's pretty much constructed, like, trying to compact it all into this movie where it's like they took a season of a show and just compacted into 90 minutes. Like, and there are a lot of ways you could tell. The story is very predictable. It's unoriginal. There's nothing, like, nothing new to add. And you know, like, every note by note about what's going on. The animation is overly cartoony, where, like, it seems to be much more fitting as a 2D animated series more than it would a computer animated feature. And a lot of the characters, they don't have a lot of development in them. They don't have, like, an arc. They're just all one-dimensional. And as much as I do credit Jenny Tartakovsky for the humor, this is another thing that I would blame Jenny Tartakovsky for. Because since he does come from a background that's only from animated series like Dexter's Lab and Samurai Jack, you know, it's just made way too much as a TV show. And, like, he should have had a bit more experience with making movies, like, just beforehand. Not as a director, but maybe as a few other things. He should have. And the second reason why it's not really that great is Johnny. Now, if I would have to explain nowadays why, in my review of Hotel Transylvania, I gave it the animat seal of garbage, it's definitely because of Johnny. He practically ruined the film for me. He's trying to be so much of this over the top modern guy, where, like, he's trying to be, like, so hip and cool for the young kids in the audience. It's just annoying. It is grating. Every single scene, it gives me a headache every single time. And it doesn't help either that Andy Samberg has given out such a terrible, annoying, and mind-numbing performance. It's just another reason why he shouldn't have a movie career and just go back to The Lonely Island. I mean, he was great there, but his movie career, I will not forgive you for that, especially after watching That's My Boy.
A rip to bed.
Yeah.
Say, what would you rather watch, Hotel Transylvania or That's My Boy?
No. Hotel Transylvania, definitely. That's another thing I want to mention. Now, this is also to say that although it is bad, I wouldn't say it's the worst film that I've seen. No, it's not the worst Adam Sandler film. Like, I take this over That's My Boy. Like I said, there are some good things. It is funny, and Adam Sandler gives out a better performance. And this isn't the worst Sony Pictures animated film. I definitely take this over the Claudy films. Like, although this is although yes, Hotel Transylvania does have the cartoony style, it's not as bad as freaking Claudy. Like, at least that one I can watch it. But yeah, it's just to say, it's pretty bad, but it's not the worst that I've seen.
Well, I hope that makes Joey very happy.
Oh no. Crap, no, you don't think he's watching?
Yeah, he might watch this episode.
No. No. Big Brother Joey might watch this. Big Brother Joey might watch this! Delete this video! Delete this video now, Mike! Delete this video!
Yeah, I haven't seen the film personally, but based upon what I've seen via reviews, clips, or whatever, it sounds like a good film I should check out.
Like, it's worth just checking out the clips, but not all of it, trust me. It's Johnny. Like, it's interesting to notice that a lot of the clips that I've seen online, I don't think I've seen any that actually does feature Johnny.
No, I don't
By the way, do you guys... Yeah, and that's the thing.
Yeah, I don't think I've actually seen a clip of Johnny, per se.
Yeah, that's the thing.
And that's the thing, they're not promoting Johnny in the clips. They're just like, oh, hey, here's Dracula, voiced by Adam Sala.
Yeah, I'm hoping it would be a miracle. I would fall in love with Jenny Tartakovsky if he decides to take out Johnny in the sequel. Like, next year. Like, that would be a godsend.
Well, you never know.
Anything because I'll say this. Without Johnny, this movie would be decent. It would be decently enjoyable.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, do you guys like Sexy and I Know It, the song?
I'm sexy and I know it. The LMFAO, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, they played it twice. Just in case you also want that image of the flop, you know?
Yeah, don't mention the music video.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Now you convince me not to see it because I hate that song of the passion.
Okay. Good.
It's overused way too much.
Yeah, even in the movie. Like I said, they played it twice.
Oversaturated.
Exactly. That's why Johnny is such a problem in that movie. I don't get how anyone would think he is tolerable.
Any other thoughts of Hotel Transylvania?
James, did you see it?
No. I like Tartakovsky's work. I like some of his earlier work.
Here.
You know, Dexter's Laboratory and some of Samurai Jack were surprising. I should say surprising hits with me because those took a little while to grow on me. But with Hotel Transylvania, especially after watching your review and a couple of other reviews, I just didn't seem very interested in it. So I just sort of gave it a pass and let it go on its merry way. What about you, Sylvie?
You know, I saw it in theaters. I liked it. I know Matt, you weren't a huge fan of the. I guess the style of the animation, was it too spastic for you?
It's just, like, it's pretty complicated. It's just not meant for computer animation. Like, that specific style. Like, this, it's just, it feels lazy, in a sense, because this is TV quality animation trying to go into movies. Trying to go like in computer animation, it just doesn't work.
I don't know if I agree with that sentiment. I kind of liked it because it's not always a perfect science of translating a cartoonist style, I guess, from two dimension to three dimension, and because that is essentially Jindy's style, right? With Dexter and with Samurai Jack, it's kind of it is more of like a jerky kind of simple basic. Like,
but that's TV. Like, it's completely different. Like, sure, you're going to... Like, we can compare Jenny Tartakovsky's work, but, like, in terms of style, like, it's television television quality and feature quality, they're two completely different things. I don't know, like, there's somehow Sony Pictures Animation and Jenny Tartakovsky has this strange fascination of trying to mix these two together. It just doesn't. Hmm. It's not the it's like it's a difference between night and day.
I just don't feel the movie would have been would better served with a different style, like maybe a more fluid style, because of what it is. It's a comedic, like, children's film. Because then you get into the weird disconnect with, like, Adam Sandler's other animated film, Eight Crazy Nights, where it looks beautiful. Like, the animation in that is really nice, but it's a comedy slash.
No.
It just doesn't, I
get what you mean, but there are it still could have been better done. Like, a good example would be, like, Madagascar or Despicable Me. Like, that is computer animation, like, with a cartoony nature done right. Like, it still feels professional. Like, it doesn't have that TV quality.
Do you think perhaps that this was intentional to make it TV quality so that a network would pick it up and make series for it? Kind of like the Madagascar series? That might have been, like, the intent.
Honestly, I was waiting for that. But for some reason, they don't. They should have, like if that was their intent, that should have already been made. Like, and I was even asking that. Why is there not a Hotel Transylvania series?
Is Jimmy tied up with something else right now? Like, what does he have too going?
He's too busy. He's still at Sony Pictures Animation. He's doing Hotel Transylvania 2. He's actually doing Popeye. And he's doing some third one I don't know. So, wow. Like, he's pretty much ball and chained at Sony. Like, I just wish he's back on television. That's his master forte, you know? Like, at least, like, if he's able to bring Hotel Trans... Like, if he's able to just quit Sony, just go to, like, Cartoon Network or something, make a Hotel Transylvania show, like, 2D and all that, even in the credits... Like, you see in the credits that, like, all the characters were 2D and stuff like that. It looks better that way than it does, like, in computer. Because it's meant more for that. Like, when I was watching Hotel Transylvania, it's like, I just wish this was a TV show and not a movie. Because this is, like, I feel like it's a wasted opportunity.
Hmm. Okay. Interesting sentiment.
Yeah.
Very
interesting. But like I said, not the worst movie, but like just
it's cute.
A TV show, seriously. Just me. Like, it's not the worst done. Like, even the animation, like, could be worse. Much worse.
And that's an interview with Matt Brunet and his thoughts on Hotel Transylvania. Now, your fans at home will be happy about that.
I'm sure they're used to it.
Nuts to them.
unless they actually decide to listen to the words I say, then they'll have an understanding.
And now let's move on to my movie choices. I'm next in line. Let's talk about a great freaking vampire-centric film. And this was on my watch list for quite some time. It's Robert Rodriguez, From Dusk Till Dawn.
Is that a recent one?
1996. Nope.
Meh.
Mr. Matt Brunet does not know what I'm talking about. Let me delve in.
I thought there was a From Dusk Till Dawn recently.
There's a series. The TV series you're thinking of.
Maybe.
I'll explain that later.
It's a Netflix exclusive.
But,
yeah,
I don't know. Hold on.
It aired on Rodriguez's El Rey network first, and then it came on a Netflix. But it does say Netflix.
Okay, yeah.
Anyways, okay. I was going to mention that after the movie, so let me just...
Study.
Yeah, that's what the confusion is. They did a series that expanded the movie. From Dusk Till Dawn is actually... this is kind of... I'm not used to Quentin Tarantino acting.
he did bit parts in his old movies, but he actually has a full-fledged, like, co-starring credit on this film with George Clooney. And the film goes, basically, these two guys rob a bank, and there's the aftermath. You know, they have a hostage in the trunk of the car, they go to a hotel, they have to escape from the police and the Texas Rangers, they have a meet-up with this cartel in Mexico, and they have to meet up this bar called the Titty Twister. This place is what you expect out of this crazy, like, hopped-up strip joint. It's Cheech Marin has, like, a couple of multiple parts in this film. He actually does a lot of characters in it. One of the characters is he's this, like, announcer at Titty Twister. He's out in front, like, saying, "Come get your pussy, everybody. We got wet pussy, we got cold pussy, we got hot pussy, we got black pussy, we got white pussy, we got all the pussy in the world. Come on in.
We got dog pussy, we got cat pussy, we got gorilla pussy." It's like going into bestiality and everything.
Yep, it was, oh man.
We got actual
pussy. If you can find
pussy.
A better deal for pussy anywhere else, fuck it.
Yeah, he actually says it, like, right to the camera, too, like, breaking the fourth wall. It was kind of funny. So,
damning it up.
Oh, yeah, he's pretty interesting in the film. So, we go into...
I wasn't acting, I was actually selling pussy.
So, yeah, the whole point of the first part of the movie, actually... part of the movie leads up to the Titty Twister. It has a build-up where you get to know the two robbers of the Gecko Brothers, and then you get to meet this family, which the Gecko Brothers steal their RV from to go to Mexico to, like, hide from the police and the Texas Rangers. You get to the Titty Twister, and then you got this... You have, oh, fuck. Why did I just forget his name? What the fuck? Machete.
Oh, Danny Trejo.
Danny Trejo.
My God. 1996, he looks young. I can never see Danny Trejo young, I guess. I saw his recent films, but I was just like, holy crap. It's this young buck. He's a bartender at Titty Twister. He's got a huge role in it somehow. It's really interesting. So Salma Hayek is in this film. Smoking hot.
Mm-hmm.
Smoking hot.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get into this, like, really carefully here. Spoilers. Major spoilers. But it's going to be a typical thing when it comes to this film, because I got to tell you the juicy details. Juicy as in blood.
Spoiler alert. Some of them are vampires.
The twist of this film is that the bar is a front for vampires. All of a sudden, they start turning into vampires, and it wreaks havoc inside the bar. There's a fight going on, there's killing going on, and it's crazy. You know that Danny Trejo turns into a vampire, Cheech Marin turns into a vampire, you got Selma Hayek turn into a vampire, and mind you, the makeup of these vampires are totally out of sight, because they have this grotesque face with the fangs. Ooh, it's ugly.
Yes, it's the Dawn of the Dead makeup guy.
Is it? Is it really?
Yep.
Because I know he stars in this film, too. He does play a bit part.
Tom Savini?
Yep, Tom Savini.
Tom Savini.
I didn't know he did the makeup for it, too. I kind of...
Oh, wait a minute. Is this the one where, like, he has that special gun?
Yep, that's the one. He's got his...
Now I know what you're talking about.
Yep, penis gun.
Yep.
Peanut pistol.
Sex Machine.
Yeah, his name is Sex Machine in the film. And, yeah, he's got that iconic penis gun or penis pistol that was featured in Machete Kills. All of a sudden, I don't know why. I guess they had to reuse the prop somehow.
Hey, it's a nice reference.
Yeah, it wasn't very nice. It was a nice reference, but it came out of nowhere in Machete Kills. Anyways, yeah, you got Tom Savini. He's like one of the He's like the last surviving people in the bar, along with Fred Williamson, who's known for his blaxploitation films and a bunch of other films. He also played the captain in Starsky and Hutch. Then you got the Gecko brothers and all the family fighting against these vampires. And Tom Savini, Fred Williamson's, everybody gets except for George Clooney and the daughter of the family.
And now you're giving the whole movie away.
I'm sorry. I fucking love this movie. I want to explain it fully. I'm sorry. My mind is flowing through with From Dusk Till Dawn. It's just, my mind can't stop thinking about it.
Just listen to this podcast and then watch the Cinemassacre Monster Madness video of it, and then you're all set. You've seen the whole thing.
I guess so.
This experience, I'm sorry. Maybe I'll bleep myself out and not spoil it for everybody then. Sorry, this film is like one of my favorites now, because the coolest thing about this, it has Kahuna Burger in it. There's a Kahuna Burger reference in this film, and it's like, okay, this opens up a whole new thing for me. It's a shared universe with From Dusk Till Dawn and Pulp Fiction. It just blew my mind when I figured that out.
It's kind of like sharing a universe between Planet Terror and Death Proof.
Yes, yes. Yeah, great.
Or in a way, you could say it could be like Kingdom Hearts.
Yeah, in layman's terms. Yeah.
Kingdom Hearts, the Quentin Tarantino edition. Instead of Donald and Goofy, it's Samuel Jackson and John Travolta.
So, From Dusk Till Dawn, I know I spoil it for you, but god damn this movie. It blew my mind.
It's an excellent film, and I think part of the reason why I like it, and trust me, I went a long time not liking George Clooney films so much, but what I like about this film in particular is that it has a very interesting transition. It starts off the first half of the movie. The first half of the movie is a heist movie. The second half of the movie is a vampire movie.
Yep.
And it manages to make that transition over actually pretty smooth, because, you know, Rodriguez's style of direction from the get-go, even during the heist segments, it's rather outlandish. The things that happen, so it's actually, you know, you get to the halfway point, it's not too hard to believe that vampires would exist in the same universe.
Yeah.
But the other thing that I like to point out is that there is a rule that this film follows, and that is a rule that's prevalent in so many different vampire films. In every good vampire movie, what you have to do is bend the rules. You know, every vampire film has a set of rules on how to deal with vampires. You know, sometimes it's a stake through the chest, sometimes it's holy water, sometimes it's a cross. Or sometimes it's all three of those. But here, this movie comes out and goes ahead and says, "Okay, you know what? We're gonna have our characters even come out and explain what's different about these vampires. They even say that they're mushy, which was
mushy.
Yes.
Yeah, because they kind of explain. Tom Savini explains that." They're mushy because, you know, when you poke a stake through the heart, it goes through. If you do that to a human, it's hard. You can't go all the way through. So if it's a vampire, it's mushy, so it's easier to put a stake through the heart.
Like his bones and stuff?
The body is all mushy. It's not like tough skin compared to us. Our vampire skin's like all mushy and loose.
That's a little bit different from what you'd expect.
Yeah, I totally forgot about that.
Yeah. So, and
that's a weird analogy.
Yeah.
And so, the other, that's one way of playing with the rules. The other way of playing with the rules that I noticed was at one point, they do use the crucifix as a weapon, but they use it in a most unusual, badass way. There's one character who puts a stick through the trigger, the hair trigger of a shotgun, and turns his shotgun into a crucifix.
Yes, so it's like
and starts shooting vampires like that.
Yeah.
Oh.
So he had a piece of wood through the, and so he could use a shotgun to kill him off, in the shape of a crucifix. That was pretty cool. Yeah.
Nice.
Oh, the action is, like, phenomenal. And the makeup and the special effects in this is, like, incredible, too. I think it should be all practical. There was, like, one point where they had to fight this vampire rat. Like, a naked mole rat-looking thing. And it looked so real and realistic. It was like, that's not CGI. That can't be CGI. That's practical, motherfucker.
Remember the good old days when it looks like it's real because it actually is?
Good old times.
Those days be these days.
So, let me jump forward a little bit to recent years. Robert Rodriguez, as you know, he has success with his films, and now he's got a TV network called El Rey, which in a sense is referenced in the film, because that's where the Gecko brothers want to go to, a place called El Rey, Mexico.
Also, it was the name of a character in Planet Terror.
Oh, that's right. Okay, yeah. See, it's referenced a lot. So he has a network on DirecTV, I believe. There aren't any other cables. Writers have it. I don't have it, so I don't watch as often. But on El Rey, he plays like exploitation films, original programming, which includes the Dawn of the Dead, Tom Savini, From Dusk Till Dawn TV series. It started on El Rey first for one season for 10 episodes, and it got moved over to Netflix for everybody else to watch, which you should all watch. Because from Dusk Till Dawn TV series, they expand it a little bit more than the film. It kind of shows you what you didn't see in the first film.
Hmm.
I'm only in the fourth episode out of 10, so far it's actually pretty darn good, actually. I'm surprised how far they go with the characters and the story of the whole movie and expand it into a TV series.
I actually had a good time trying to watch this with Mike. I'm not gonna lie, we had a viewing of the From Dusk Till Dawn pilot episode, and that was partway through the second episode in which I fell right to sleep.
Yep. So,
and he's a witness to that. But while it is a good show. And I think it said that it was actually directed by Rodriguez.
Yeah, the pilot episode was. And the I think most of the episodes were directed and written by Robert Rodriguez, I believe. But yeah, he helms it very well.
He does this. However, this raises sort of a concern for me about Rodriguez's career. He no longer has any original ideas.
They don't agree.
Time out.
Wait.
I mean, that's coming from a guy who liked his earlier stuff like Desperado and whatnot. Most of his stuff in the 90s, I even liked Spy Kids 3D Game Over, but
with evil, she rests alone.
But the fact that, you know, Rodriguez is returning, is returning to this, think about it, it's even on the El Rey Network, which we already established is a title that he's used before several times. It's like he no longer has original ideas.
So, based upon from my
sorry, I just need to point out I'm on his IMDb page, and apparently I just want to mention that one of his projects in development apparently is called Machete Kills Again ... in space.
Yes.
No. Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
I'm looking at it right now.
You haven't seen Machete Kills and seen the trailer for it? It's going to be phenomenal.
In space?
Yes, in space. The second film at the end explains it, how it's going to happen.
Yeah. I like Planet Terror. I like Sin City. Every time that he comes up with something that's simple and original, although I have to admit, Sin City was somebody else's source material to begin with, so he had something great, he had something good to work with. Mm-hmm. Same with Planet Terror.
Frank Miller stuff, so yeah.
The Machete franchise is just an example of him taking another franchise idea and running with it till he runs out. Like he did with Spy Kids, like he did with Desperado when it became Once Upon a Time in Mexico.
And then when he tried to revive Spy Kids, like, what?
Mm-hmm.
Spy Kids 4.
So now he's with the From Dusk Till Dawn, the series, he's reviving that again.
See, and the side I got from Robert was that when he did the film, he says, hands down, it's his favorite film he ever worked on. And he said that he wanted to explore the mythos, you know, with the Aztec Mexico kind of mythos and the vampires and the franchise itself. Because he had a lot more that he didn't put on screen for the first film. And he wanted to explore it more in a series, which I'm fine with. I have no problem with it. I guess when it comes to originality for Robert Rodriguez, I'm fine with it. It's just, sure, milking out Machete, of course. You gotta do your Machete films, your Spy Kids. You gotta make money somehow. You can't just... Maybe you gotta go back to something familiar for somebody, and then later on create something new.
But even among those films, the tropes and the way that he delivers the story is always it always seems a little bit the same. We're not Robert Rodriguez movies, though. That's another subject. I think we're really getting off topic.
Thank you, but. Anyways, yeah, From Dusk Till Dawn is actually, even though I
spoiled, oh yeah, vampires.
Even though I spoiled it for a couple of parts, it's definitely worth a watch. And mind you, From Dusk Till Dawn, the series is not a continuation of the first film. It's just a expansion of the mythos of the first film a lot more.
Yeah. It's an expansion pack.
Yeah, it's an expansion pack of the first film. I'm not even going to mention the sequel or prequel of From Dusk Till Dawn. Those two are crap. From Dusk Till Dawn 2 and 3 are not even worth the watch. If 2 is the sequel, 3 is the prequel. I did, however, want to say something about how they show vampirism in From Dusk Till Dawn the series. They do show on early on that one of the characters in the show that we've seen in the film is a vampire, and the way they show the fangs is kind of weird. It's not like from the film where they turn into a grotesque vampire. They kind of go into a modernized vampire where the eyes go red, but the fangs are like a snake where they kind of pop out like a snake and bite people. It's kind of kind
yeah,
of...
we're in a new age of vampires. It's not they're no longer grotesque, but like they still got to manage the pretty boy. Like it's like I want to suck your blood with style
and body.
I'm gonna get to that actually with one of my choices.
And dear lord.
So, from the Mexicans vampires to a African-American look on vampires, let's go to Sylvie with her film.
Okay.
We've got African-American vampires?
We've got they exist. Yeah, it's a small minority, no pun intended, but... So, when we were guessing the topic last week...
The neighborhood.
Oh, God.
I was, I guessed Eddie Murphy because, of course, when I think Halloween, I think Eddie Murphy, duh, but no. So when I found out we were doing vampires, I'm like, oh, so, you know, kill two birds with one stone, because there is an Eddie Murphy film where he plays a vampire, and it's the 1995 horror comedy classic, I don't know, Vampire in Brooklyn. It's an interesting film. Like, I haven't seen all of Eddie Murphy's movies. He is one of my favorite actors and comedians. And in fact, one of my favorite movies is Coming to America, which is an Eddie Murphy film. But this is, it's an interesting project. It was directed by Wes Craven. He's the guy that directed, I believe, Scream.
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah, like he did a lot of directing and writing for some horror movies. So you think that, and then you think, well, why pick Eddie Murphy? It's not, he seems kind of like an odd choice for a vampire film. The only reason Eddie Murphy agreed to work on this film was in exchange, Paramount had released the rights to The Nutty Professor, I guess the original Nutty Professor, to Eddie Murphy, I think, and that's what allowed him to do The Nutty Professor later on. Mm. So it was a bit of a transaction to get him in the movie. So it's a horror comedy, which I don't know too many, because I actually don't like horror. It's one of my least favorite genres. Comedy is one of my favorite genres. So I think it takes a really good movie for me to laugh and be scared, like scare the crap out of me. The only movie so far that I could think of that does that is Shaun of the Dead. Because that's like a rom-zom com. Mm-hmm. It's funny, yeah. But at the same time, it legitimately scared me because, you know, zombies. But this movie, it kind of fails as a comedy and as a horror because it's not scary in the slightest. There's decent amount of blood.
It's Eddie Murphy. Like, are you going to be expect to be scared of Eddie Murphy in that movie?
Okay, but here's the thing. Like, the weird thing about...
Come on there. Oh, yeah, this is great.
I'm making waffles.
No, that's the thing about this movie. He's actually the straight man in this. Like, he's the villain. So he's supposed to be the bad guy. Figure that out. It's like jumping back to...
It's like Christopher Walken being the villain of Country Bears.
Yeah, it's an odd choice. So... I'd say 80% of the movie he's playing it straight, but he does kind of ham it up, and he can't help himself. He's Eddie Murphy, right? There's certain scenes where the movie kind of derails, like it's trying to take itself very seriously, and then there'll be a scene where Eddie Murphy suddenly transforms into like a preacher, and he starts preaching about how evil is good, and he starts pointing out people in the conjugation, like, she's a hoe, and he does drugs, and this and that, And then another instance where he transforms into an Italian guy called Guido, and which is interesting. Like the shtick is actually, like, I think from Raw, because he did a stand-up comedy, routine, Raw and Delirious, but in Raw he does like a really good Italian accent, so they made him up to look like Italian. The makeup's not, it's not Nutty Professor Coming to America quality. It's actually really kind of bad, but it's kind of a precursor to what you eventually see in the later films. There's no Rick Baker working at all in this film. But anyway, so like the plot of the movie. So how it works is there's, if I remember, Eddie Murphy narrates in the beginning and says there's a bunch of vampires that originated in Africa, and then somehow they ended up in Barbados, and then they all got killed except two of them, and he's one of the last ones. So that's why he had to hijack a ship and go to and sail it to Brooklyn, which is where the final vampire is, the other vampire, and he wants to like preserve the bloodline of these vampires because they're the only two left. So as he's going around trying to find this person, he's, you know, killing, you know, causing, stirring up whatnot. So there's these two detectives on this case. There's this man named Justice and his partner, his new kind of spastic partner, Rita. And as it turns out, coincidentally, Rita is the, she happens to be the other vampire that Eddie Murphy is, or Maximilian, that's his character, is looking for. So basically the whole movie is kind of like a back and forth of him trying to seduce her, or trying to get her to succumb to her half-vampire heritage. And then there's this love triangle because Rita's also attracted to Justice, and Justice likes her, and Maximilian's trying to break that up. So there's also a bit of like contrived romance sprinkled in there as well. It's not executed in the best way. It's just wrong seeing Eddie Murphy as a villain. It kind of brings up the same emotions as when I watched Death to Smoochie and Robin Williams as the bad guy. But at least in that case, there was some redemption. You don't really get that here. He plays the villain, and he plays it almost too well. Like you can't like someone who abuses animals, right? And there's actually two instances in the movie where animals are just sort of like, they're just like obliterated. Like, and it's not even provoked. It's like, there's a scene where a police dog's barking. He's not biting anyone, he's just barking. And then, you know, I think like Eddie Murphy snaps his fingers, and next thing you know, the dog bursts into flames and then like flies into the harbor in the water. So yeah, a little not too good. And then there's another scene in an Italian restaurant with the cat. And I think when he's Guido, he basically shoots the cat and it explodes in a flurry of fur. So yeah, if you're an animal lover, you will not like Eddie Murphy in this film. So yeah, it goes on. It drags. Like there's some good scenes by some of the supporting actors. John Witherspoon is in this film. He's the dad in Friday. He's also he plays that blind dude in Soul Plane. You know, he's doing his shtick here, but it's funny. And he plays off of, I think this name, this guy named Kadeem, who's Julius Kadeem, Jones.
Kareem Campbell, Hardison? I think. Kadeem Hardison.
Kadeem Hardison. Yeah, and he plays like the henchman to Eddie Murphy. And he gets turned into a ghoul through, I guess, like the transfer of blood between Eddie Murphy and him. So he becomes this like henchman that can be his eyes during the day. But the only drawback to that, even though Eddie Murphy says, "Oh, you got these wonderful powers, I've afforded to you this wonderful opportunity, you should be thankful." Like every time we see the character, he's more and more deteriorating. Like he's losing his eyes, losing his arm, his hand. So he's just getting like uglier and uglier, like towards as the movie goes. So it's where's my thought process going? Yeah, it's it has its moments where you kind of get like a cheap chuckle, but It's not. Angela Bassett. Sorry, the character that plays Rita, Angela Bassett. If I could, I guess the most recent role most people would recognize her. She played a character in, I think, American Horror Story. I haven't watched that, but she was in that. She played Tina Turner in What's Love Got to Do with It, and I don't know, the mom in Aquila the Bee. But like, she's like I guess you could call her a scream queen in the sense that there's many scenes of her just like losing her shit. Like, she just, most of the movie is just her screaming and then just like running and flailing her arms like, ah, ah, ah! And it's an awful film, but not as worse, not as best. Eddie Murphy's got a bad accent in this, bad perm, just unnecessary violence.
It's like, I see he has long hair, and it's like, what?
Yeah, it's a wig.
It's a wig, yeah. But yeah, Eddie Murphy, there's actually a trivia thing there saying, I think he feels like the movie, part of the reason the movie didn't take was because of the bad wig. Because I guess women couldn't really get turned on by that Al Sharpton do. Like,
it was something like that. It was in an interview with Rolling Stone, and he said that the wig was just, people didn't like it, and that's how it went downhill.
I just took my wig and I made it point at the box office, and I told him, this is your fault. See that? This is all done by you.
No, but if there's I gotta say about Vampire in Brooklyn, it does sound a lot like some of his other movies, where it's like you get like the foreigner now going to the big city, like coming to America, and it's like, is there really that much of a difference? And plus the fact that, like, I understand why they would get Eddie Murphy, because keep in mind, this is the 90s. This was like Eddie Murphy's prime, pretty much. And so, like, they mostly got him for, like, the star, for, like, mostly for star value. And it's kind of weird that they got him to be kind of a straight man. Because, like, he's never, like, it's rare that he would be a straight man. I don't think he would ever be. Like, maybe there was one instance, but that didn't really go well.
He kind of played the straight man in Dreamgirls, because he wasn't that. He actually got nominated for
Dreamgirls. Well then, okay.
I mean, that's after the fact, obviously, but I get what you're saying.
Well, I meant something before, but his soul was kind of taken away during that part. But it's kind of weird hearing about Vampire in Brooklyn. It's just, you know, you got better options. Just stick to coming to America.
I agree. It's not the best Eddie Murphy film, perhaps. But here's the thing: I don't know what the best Eddie Murphy film is. I still enjoy this film, even if it's like, you know, some people say it might be a little bit tonally imbalanced. I didn't mind the wig or anything, although I did mind the shininess on his skin during the preacher segment. That was a little bit distracting. When he puts on the preacher during that one scene, suddenly his skin is just like really, really shiny, and I'm like, what?
I gotta admit, he does have a really shiny forehead.
But here's another point I wanted to make. I mentioned earlier how good vampire movies usually bend the rules a little bit. Here's how it's bent here. They establish that an advanced vampire can kill a victim and take on their persona for a period of time. This is not very typical of vampire movies or vampire stories.
No, it's not. Uh-huh. He's I'm glad you made that point, James, because this is one thing, this is what I wanted to bring up. I did like a quick search. I can't remember if it was Wikipedia or another site, and I just wrote down some of like the general vampire powers that you normally see in media and pop culture. So I made a short list of so generally the powers of a vampire, they're immortal, they have enhanced strength, enhanced speed, unnatural healing, shape-shifting / absorption, psychic powers, telekinesis, and pyrokinesis. Eddie Murphy has all of these in the movie, so you could argue he's almost like a vampiric Gary Stu, because he doesn't seem to have any sort of weakness aside from the obvious, like, stake through the heart. Mm-hmm. So it's just interesting to know. And he doesn't turn into a bat. He turns into, like, a wolf, but he still has, like, all the powers that you think of when you think generally of vampires.
I think I can see the problem with the wig, because like I'm seeing some of the pictures of Eddie Murphy as the vampire.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't remind me of a vampire. He looks like Snoop Dogg. Just give him seriously. You give him like sunglasses, and he's gonna go walking around for shizzle.
Actually, what I was sort of thinking was take a picture of that and then compare it to a California raisin.
Oh, my God.
No, hold on.
We need a side-by-side comparison there, please.
Okay, look. Okay, here's Eddie Murphy.
Oh, God.
I need, like... Okay, maybe not about the dreadlock. Like, you could see a bit of Snoop Dogg in him, but here, like, here's something like, here, maybe this one.
Cover the eyes. And...
Yeah, hold on. And then there's this. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, you could see it. Come on.
Oh, he's loading. Okay, here we go.
See it. Just give Eddie Murphy sunglasses. It's freaking Snoop Dogg.
That probably would have been the better. It's that and the beard.
Yeah.
It's the beard.
It's the D-O-double-G, man.
It's the beard, yeah. It's the D-O-double-G. It's the beard, not the wig.
Yeah, the hair, that hairstyle, it's like...
It enhances it. Like, maybe it's not that style, but, like, you can see where it's going.
I kind of see where he's coming from here.
I think the hair's a little more Lionel Richie, you know?
Yeah, or, like, it's dreadlocked. It's almost like Marley. You got to find an old picture from, like, the 90s, I think. I think that's a more recent photo of him with that hairstyle.
Yeah.
Oh boy. Hold on a sec.
Maybe he saw Vampire in Brooklyn and said, "Yeah, man, this is brilliant. Yo, I gotta get me that hair."
yeah.
I have a rizzle.
That's a pimp do for sure.
Yeah, I've seen this film a long time ago, but I vaguely remember it. But
I don't know. I mean, okay, I'll be honest. I don't. It doesn't look like Snoop Dogg ages. I don't know.
It's all that weed. The weed has a fountain of youth problem.
Really? I thought it was the meth.
I have epilepsy.
With that in mind, let's talk about the granddaddy of all vampire films. James, give me a gist of what that is for us.
Take it away, James! Finally!
Okay. So here we have... Like he said, just for this this podcast, I went into the Wayback Machine, and all the way back to 1922, with the first ever feature-length adaptation of Bram Stoker's Dracula, but it's better known as Nosferatu. Yes, this is a black-and-white German silent film production. They had to have a a lawsuit to prove that this was actually the Dracula story, but essentially what they did here with the film and its story is they took the story from the book Dracula and just renamed the characters. Hmm. So, does this make it a bad movie? No. Nope. What it is, it perfectly captures the type of mood that was prevalent in cinematography at the time. We're talking sort of a chiaroscuro lighting scheme that was very popular in Hollywood. Not just Hollywood, but all over the world. It was very popular with overly romanticizing how films were shot. And in this movie, if you just sort of look at different frames of it, you can see how well there was attention put into the details, sometimes even during the shadow work. Here's an example of the shadow work in action right here.
Yes.
As if you want to know where this type of motif originally came from, this is the movie.
This is like the pioneering of like how horror films uses shadows as a fear element.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, everything is very much like this in the movie, and on top of that, you have the fact that this movie also did set a very strong precedent for how vampire films were viewed even up until now, I think. With Nosferatu, there's generally two types of ideas or two general types of ideas on how vampires are viewed. There is the rat-like monster vampire, which you can see here.
Well, it's more bat-like, actually.
Rat, bat. It's a very beastly type of vampire. Less human, going for more animalistic traits. There's another picture that probably sets a better idea of it. Uh-huh. And the opposite of that is the sexy vampire.
Yep.
Which is not really pictured here per se, but
it's something that the ladies will go gaga over.
Maybe not.
You ain't seeing that vampire sparkle.
but here's the point I'm getting at, though. Remember what I tell you. This is still following the Dracula story, so he's still trying to enchant the ladies by hypnotizing them and putting them under his spell. So in that sense, you don't really have a sexy vampire here, but you do have the precursor to Dracula and a lot of the more suave portrayals of vampires. And dare I say it, we still have the ancestors of these vampire tropes today. This rat-like vampire you might see in something like the next film, which I will be discussing. And the sexy vampire, believe it or not, is kind of what Twilight got right. But, I'll leave it at that. Or you might even go for Underworld. Who knows? There's a film series with a nice cross of rat-like and sexy vampires.
She's gone. Mm. Anyways, there's actually one thing that I want to mention about Nosferatu, and it's just going to be a little mention of another movie.
I know what it is.
Has a really interesting concept. It's Shadow of the Vampire, which apparently it's pretty much the making of Nosferatu, which even features some of the cast is like some of the actors. I don't mean in real life, but like they portray as like the actual actors and even the director. And Willem Dafoe plays the guy who plays Nosferatu. Max Schreck. The interesting twist about it is that Willem Dafoe, Nosferatu, is actually a real vampire, which really gives it an interesting twist. You know, like nowadays when we have movies like Saving Mr. Banks or Hitchcock or movies like that, they're good in their own rights, but I do feel like Shadow of a Vampire, although, yeah, it's not really realistic, they do put in a really interesting twist in the making of style of films. Sylvie, we're talking about Shadow of the Vampire, by the way.
Which is it's sort of a companion piece to Nosferatu. It satires the making of the film by suggesting what if Max Schreck, the actor who played Graf Orlok, the vampire in the film, was actually a vampire.
Yeah, apparently it was also nominated for 2 Oscars. Willem Dafoe got supporting role and best makeup.
Yeah, the makeup was pretty good. They made Dafoe look like, well, Dafoe. when you have the last name Dafoe, you can't help but be typecast as a villain. But
well, he's not always a villain. Would you say Gil is a villain?
No.
Exactly.
I'm playing with you. But seriously, this Shadow of the Vampire is also a very good film. It pays obviously homage to the production of Nosferatu, but also if you watch the film at certain points, there's that shadow segment that I sent you guys. They have a shot that plays out like that in the film, just as sort of a nod to the original movie.
So would you say it's more of an homage, or it's a little bit like Ed Wood, where they would make fun and pay tribute to the subject matter?
It's like Ed Wood.
Okay.
I should say. Although a little less on the Burton side of things.
Okay. No, but I will say, just the idea of Shadow of the Vampire, it could kind of ruin the original Nosferatu, because now you're just gonna, like, you'll watch the original movie and you'll just think of Willem Dafoe, like when he played the Green Goblin in Spider-Man. Like, you're just gonna see that shadow scene. The itsy bitsy spider went out the water spout.
Oh, the script girl. I'll eat her later. Mm-hmm. Willem Dafoe going full out.
Yeah.
Apparently, as a settlement in court, it was Bram Stoker's widow that sued the company that made Nosferatu. And as part of the settlement, they said to have all the negatives and all the copies of the film destroyed. So they did. Except it was very tricky. See, by that point, they had already distributed the film worldwide. So you could only destroy copies of the film found in Germany, but everywhere else, the film still survived.
Interesting.
It's kind of like, you ever watched the movie Hugo?
The Martin Scorsese's one?
Yeah. If you don't recall it, you don't get... It's okay. But yeah, they've remastered this, and people, fans of this film love it so much that they've released it and re-released it with whatever they can, HD remasters, different film tinting, which actually I sort of think ruins the mood a bit. But and also they've even replaced the score to give it a more synthesized score, which seems a little unnecessary at some points, but it goes to show how much people still obsess over this movie.
Mm-hmm. Plus, he like even randomly reference on SpongeBob.
Yeah, that one episode. Yeah.
I was just looking at the clip right now.
Really?
Yeah. I'm just looking at.
I remember that episode.
Nosferatu.
Yeah,
yeah. You see Nosferatu actually smile.
I still think to this day that the Grand High Witch in The Witches was her design was inspired by Nosferatu.
The what?
That book, the Roald Dahl book?
Oh, from the one from the movie.
Okay.
Which one?
The Angelica Houston character.
And the witch one.
Yes, the witches. Well, here's you got that image in your head. Here's the image that I'm talking about right here. There you go.
Jesus.
You gotta warn someone before you put something up like that. Ugh.
Jeez!
Plastic surgery gone wrong there.
Shh. Oh my goodness, we just, I just scared the bejesus out of Matt.
Jeez, dude!
Nightmares tonight.
Pretty much.
I don't know. Couple beers, a wig, you could still,
I don't...
Hey, pretty lady, will you have a swing at my body tonight? Hey, I like your nose there. Okay,
that's a fine little nose. Bling, 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 bling.
Even with beer goggles, she'll just, like, she'll just upgrade to, like, Witch Hazel.
I got something, too, that sticks out like that. Here, let me show you.
Oh. All right, we're going.
Whoa!
But
I think you mean the chin. Are you talking about the chin? Oh God! The chin even has like hair. Oh.
Oh my God!
It reminds me of Men in Black 2. It's a bald chinian.
Do you kick her in the chin and she just goes, oh.
Oh.
If you haven't seen Nosferatu, it is on Netflix on Instant Quo, so go check it out whenever you can.
Alright.
With that, we come full circle back to Matt with his very suggestive second choice, which I wasn't surprised about knowing.
It's a strange choice, but a pretty interesting film, actually.
Yeah, talk about it.
It's, some of you may know it as 30 Days of Nights. Now, when you hear the concept, it does sound interesting. As you guys may know, one of the biggest weaknesses for vampires is pretty much sunlight. Well, what happens if you're in a place where it's rare that sunlight would happen? So, apparently, everybody is in Alaska, and they're celebrating this day, like this special moment in Alaska where, for like an entire month, for like 30 days, the sun won't come up. So,
hooray,
like,
we get to sleep.
So, yeah, it must be like way up north. But then, there are vampires who come in, and pretty much they have a feast all over, and they don't know what to do. And they're pretty much becoming pretty unstoppable and stuff like that. So, in a way, it's a little it's a little bit like the generic, monster slasher film where you're mostly there for the kill, seeing vampires going waka 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 over the people. And it seems like nothing is going to stop them because, well, I mean, where's the sunlight? They really don't have much. But, like, in a way, I feel like 30 Days of Nights has a bit of an inspiration of The Thing. Because, like, and I don't mean, like, yeah, it's set up north or stuff like that, but if you really think about it, like, the people are in this isolated place in Alaska, and, like, they're pretty much stuck in the middle of nowhere with this, like, with crazy, mad, like, crazy hungry vampires and stuff like that. And although they do look, the vampires themselves, like, they do look a tad bit generic and stuff like that. Well, they have a bit, well, I do admit, they do have a bit of a bat design to them. Like, here, let me show you this one. Although on one side, the more you look at it, the more it looks a little bit goofy. Like this one right here is like, Although there are a few,
oh my goodness,
there
it's
are
a bald South Jersey Sam.
Hey there, folks.
God.
Oh God. No, yeah, this is his revenge for Five Nights at Freddy's. No, but anyways, now there is one unique thing also at the end. Like, the ending does have a unique way of killing off the vampires. Yeah, there's going to be spoilers for this one as well. I don't know if you guys are going to be interested in seeing it anyways, but what they decided to do... Oh my god, here's another goofy one.
You see, none of these pictures you're sending me compares to Angelica Houston. A children's movie is more frightening than this.
I can have cookie. This is another I can have cheeseburger. No, but I will admit, the ending is pretty unique. Because one of the guys, what he has to do in order to kill the vampire... His strategy is pretty much to fight fire with fire. So the guy, like, he injected himself with vampire blood and he became a vampire in order to stop the other vampires. Which kind of gives it an interesting twist. But then it has a sad ending because the 30 days are up.
Aww.
And then, like... Yeah, it's the worst time to have Beatles music, if you know what I mean.
Here comes the sun.
There you go. Thank you, James.
Here
it's
comes
all right.
Sun.
No, actually, no, it's not all right. Okay, I'm just gonna.
It's all right.
Yeah.
I'm melting. He crisps in the song, you know.
Little darling, I hear that you kill the vampires this way. Little darling.
Yeah.
So another way that a good vampire movie fools with the recipe is it the neck bite that does the that deems you a vampire, or is it something in the bloodstream? Apparently, now, this movie goes for the bloodstream.
I'm trying to remember, but I think they just kill them off. I don't know if they turn into vampires. Yeah, like, I don't think there are people who actually turn, like, there are some that turn into vampires. They're mostly the kind that would just kill. Because, like, it's not all vampires that can just suck the blood and then they become vampire.
Okay.
Yeah. This is transferred more like a zombie plague, I guess.
Yeah, it's pretty much, yeah, it's think a little bit like The Thing. It's pretty much, yeah, it's like a vampire version of The Thing, because they're way up north, they're in an isolated area, and, you know, they got vampires, just go free, and they all have fun.
So this was produced by Sam Raimi's house of production.
And it's actually, I think I know where this is going.
I'm not going to mention it, James.
Okay,
I'm not going to mention what we've been through. It's a long story. But I did notice it's also based on a comic book miniseries, too. So it's based... It's a comic book movie, in a nutshell. Mm-hmm. So if you've read the miniseries, you might like this movie. Actually, have you seen the sequel?
Sequel?
A direct-to-video sequel called... 30 Days and Nights, Dark Days. Yeah, there was a sequel. There was a sequel that came out.
Dark Days make... Dark Days... Like, I'm looking at the bulletin on the DVD. Dark Days make Twilight look like nursery school.
Oh, yeah, it's on the DVD. It's on the cover, yeah, it's on the poster. That's hilarious.
As if Twilight is not already a nursery school.
Oh my god, that's hilarious.
Yes, can't we go back to the sexy vampires?
No more sexy vampires. Let me,
What, is that the photos I sent you are not sexy?
No, they're not sexy.
How can you say no to those pearly whites that has a bit of red in them?
Let me talk about what I had to endure for my second film.
Oh, boy.
And this kind of goes in hand with Nosferatu a little bit. I'll explain when I talk about it. So, TV movie. Sci-fi. Casper
right
Van Dien.
Keep going.
Who is known for... Starship Troopers. Coolio is in this film.
Uh-huh.
So, another black vampire. Spoilers.
Oh my god.
This film is called Dracula 3000.
That already sounds bad.
A television horror movie released in 2004 that brings Bram Stoker's fictional vampire Count Dracula into outer space in the distant 30th century. Despite its name, it's not a sequel to Dracula 2000, and it has no connection to that movie at all.
Nor does it have any connection to Futurama, unfortunately.
No.
Any sense.
So, Casper Van Dien plays Captain Abraham Van Helsing.
Oh my god, really?
Yes. So, and honest to god, I try to flash back to it now and I can't remember what happened in the movie because I was so bored and not interested in this movie. So I'm actually reading the synopsis on Wikipedia to remind myself. So,
oh my god.
Okay, they must have really failed. I mean, it's Dracula in space.
No.
The fridge can you... What?
It's not Dracula. Let me talk about this.
But it says Count Dracula terrorizes the crew of a spaceship.
Let me talk about what happens in the film. So it's set in the year 3000. It kind of flashes back 30 years
ago. Into the year 3000.
In the film, they often flash back to 30 years
into 2930, I believe. And they talk about this ship that's been invaded, and the guy's in his chair. He's got a crucifix. He's kind of doing like a captain's log. And you see that once in a while in the film. But otherwise, the main plot is that Captain Van Deen, as Abraham Van Helsing, his crew finds a ship, and they go check it out. And it kind of reminds me of Firefly in a way. So they go on the ship. And Coolio, he plays a character named 187. I don't know why it's a number. I don't know why. I don't really care. But I don't really care. So Coolio, he's typical, you know, pothead. He's like, hey, man, I want to get some pot, man. Let's go smoke some, man, kind of character.
Stereotyping.
So they look around the ship, and there's a guy named Humvee who's played by Tiny Lister.
He's Tommy Tiny Lister.
Yeah.
Yep.
So they go to a cargo bay area and they see these coffins. You know, think about it. What do you think of when you think see coffins?
Dead bodies.
Dead people.
187's like, hey man, there's gotta be some stuff in here. Let's open these coffins up. So
why?
He's a pothead. He's gotta look for something to take home. So he has a crowbar, he opens it up, he cuts himself, he's bleeding, and he opens a coffin, he sees sand. Gee, what's gonna happen next?
They're gonna play Sandman?
Blood drips into the sand, and out comes the headmaster, the King Vampire Mall, and he gets bitten right away. Coolio gets bitten by the Master of Vampires. He
was looking for a fix.
He's like, Master, I'm at your command now. What do you want me to do? I want you to kill the crew. Okay, Master. And Coolio, mind you, even though I thought it was boring, this film actually brought Coolio into like a weird, goofy side, acting as a vampire. He's like, hey, man, I see what you did there. I'm gonna push you over there. I'm gonna have fun with you. He has a fun time with the role. I kid you not.
Well, at least someone is.
Oh, he's like, I kid you not, he's the best part of a movie, even though everything else is shit. So they get whiff of this, and they go around, and there's a professor. He's in a wheelchair, of course, and
Professor X?
I wish. Oh, how I wish. So they find computers.
We would have taken him back to our station. Try to examine what's wrong with him. Make sure he gets far away from Magneto.
So
we don't want that crap to happen again.
So, Captain,
Dracula, we have a special school for people with your skills.
So Captain Van Helsing gets a glimpse of this, like, past captain's log, and he gets information that the ship was originally on the planet Transylvania.
There's a planet Transylvania.
In the year 3000, there's a planet called Transylvania that's full of vampires. Who knew?
That and must be next to Treasure Planet and all that stuff, you know?
I'm not making this shit up, mind you.
It's next to it's also a neighbor to the planet UK.
What UK? Planet UK?
What? Well, if we're gonna take the name of a country and just slap it on a planet, we might as well just be consistent, right?
So anyways,
this planet over here is Switzerland. This planet over here is Poland.
So,
and then you got Scotland, who wants to be a moon, but they can't. They have to stay in the planet UK.
Exactly.
So, they must do research about vampires, because in the year 3000, you don't know jack shit about vampires. You don't know how to kill them. You don't know nothing about them. So the professor's like on the computer typing it in, and he's like, what the fuck is this? Van Helsing, I have some news for you. I believe that your ancestor is Mr. Abraham Van Helsing. And Van Helsing's like,
No. Really? It's just a coincidence. Just a coincidence.
You know the Helsing name is very popular. You know, Smith, you know, Mr. Smith, Mr. Jones, Mr. Helsing, you know that stuff.
So
yeah, in the year 3000 they got rock stars by the name of Helsing, so you know.
So I guess the whole reason why this vampire is attacking is because of the history of Van Helsing. So it's like, he wants to get the captain. He's the victim of the whole ship. Everybody else is dying because of Van Helsing. So they look up how to kill vampires, and they know, okay, oh, wooden stakes, holy water, crucifix, all that stuff. There's a whole room in the spaceship that's full of crucifix, which will be used later in the movie. For other vampires that pop out of the coffins that 187 pulls up for some odd reason, some stupid vampires. So let me talk about this. It's not Dracula 3000. It's not Dracula. So at one point there's this first mate of Van Helsing named Aurora. She is a robot. So throughout the whole film everybody's like wondering. Shut up.
Oh. Castlevania. Ha ha. I see what you did there.
You should have done the game over one.
That would have been a text tone.
Now you got the now you're pissing off the avid players, giving them bad memories.
It's the first one, not the sequel. That's a song. So as I was saying, Aurora, everybody's wondering like, did he bite you? Did he bite you? And it's like, no, I'm a robot, you idiot. I don't get bitten by vampires. So they had a conversation, this vampire and Aurora, and he's like, you know, his name is Count Orlok.
Orlok?
Not Count Dracula. His name is Count Orlok.
Mm-hmm. Like the character Graf Orlok in Nosferatu.
Why? Why is this the movie? It's like, it's titled Dracula 3000. It says Dracula is attacking the spaceship, not Orlok. I don't
understand. That wouldn't sell. It wouldn't sell. Who would watch Orlok?
Also, one thing I noticed, like, I'm seeing a bit of the trailer. Is he still seriously wearing that like, old cape and stuff like that?
Yes. Yeah, he's dressed up as Count Dracula. He's got the red cape with the black cape kind of thing going on. It's got the, you know, it's a very cheesy costume. Yes, it's cheesy for a sci-fi movie. Yes, it's very cheesy. Yes. That's my problem. It's not Dracula. It's fucking Orlok from Nosferatu. It's like, wait a minute, did this film have problems with copyright? Because the original film had problems with copyright. It's like, did they change the character from Dracula to Orlok just to make people happy? No.
Like, did he at least have, like, the teeth and stuff like that?
Yeah,
you know, like...
yeah, all the trademarks. All the trademarks are there.
Like the Nosferatu? Like...
No, the Dracula trademarks. Nothing...
They should have just called it not Dracula 3000.
And so... All right, so...
Like, I think even Adam Sandler Dracula is going like, the hell, man?
So...
Seriously, I mean, like, this is Dracula 3000. Like, try to boost him up a bit, you know?
Yeah,
get some gear on him. Like, get some machinery. Like, even the poster,
yeah,
like...
Yeah, the poster. I thought the movie is going to be so freaking fantastic. It's going to be like this amazing, you know, futuristic vampire kind of film, and it's just like, no. Blood into sand, boom, we got a vampire. Oh, hey, this is a guy named Count Orlok. He's just like as Dracula. Ooh, not frightening. There's even a female vampire here that gets killed because she was in a coffin, because apparently from planet Transylvania, they're transporting all the vampires to planet Earth, you know, to... like repopulate or something. I don't know. It's just really stupid. So the only way to kill it is, you know, they had pieces of wood from the coffins to try to kill the other vampires. They don't have a chance to stab
Count Orlok in the heart. So the last two remaining survivors of the damn ship, which is Humvee, played by Tiny, and Aurora, who is a robot. So their last resort, spoiler alert, is to drive into the sun. They take their ship and navigate to the sun. You know, sunlight, because it kills the vampires. So they drive into the sunlight, and Tiny...
We'll accept them.
So Humvee and Aurora just accept their fate and explode with the vampire. Done. That's how it ends. You see this big explosion, the CGI explosion at the end. This cheesy CGI explosion at the end. It's like, okay, they're dead. Okay. No sequel, no nothing. All right, good. Good.
Back away. Back away.
Good. Good. Before Aurora, the robot, she was like first mate. But she's before that, she claims to Tiny, oh, hey, I used to be a pleasure bot.
What?
That's convenient. Famous last words.
Yeah, and that's how it ends. That it's like, and in the future you get credits instead of money, so it's like, he's like, I know what present pleasure bots are. I never had enough credits to earn one.
Oh God, I just realized. That means this movie exists in the same universe as Heart Beeps.
So, and towards the end, he's like, Humvee's like, okay, also sign for me. Picks up the robot and just goes off, and then you see the explosion. Like, yep, they pleasured before they died in the explosion.
I will not die a virgin.
The ending sounds kind of hot.
Yeah, but I'm...
Oh, God.
Dang, she's got some spice.
Dracula 3000 is the worst film I've ever seen in my life. Oh, my God. I need to
get... You haven't seen Zombie Lake yet.
I don't...
Oh.
There's probably a lot worse than Zombie Lake. I kind of dig that more than anything else. I love cheesy 80 movies.
Well, if you're talking about the worst movies you've ever seen, let's just say that you guys all have a misunderstanding.
I'm just gonna leave it at that and let you guys figure out the rest.
Yeah, the only thing that I have to say about this movie, I haven't seen even so much as a clip of it, and I'm kind of glad, because from what I'm hearing, I have remember what I said about a good vampire movie plays with the rules? Well, this movie doesn't play with the rules. Therefore, it's a bad vampire movie.
It doesn't even it doesn't even give anything. It doesn't even like do anything special. I mean, nope. Like seriously, no. You're going with the classic Dracula style.
Wait,
and when it's set in the freaking future, I mean, dude.
Wait, all right. I told this James and I had it. We're talking about this the other day, and I want to quote a review. Let me see if I can find it. Let's see who did this. Mitchell Hadaway of DVD Verdict said, Dracula 3000 is a shining example of complete filmmaking incompetence. You can look all you want and you won't find the slightest hint of intelligence or any on any level. It sucks. Pun intended.
Well,
no. Best part here. Last line. Dracula 3000 makes Leprechaun 4 in space look like Alien.
Oh, dude.
See, that should have been the warning all along. See, this is what happens when you take established horror movie ideas and franchises and stick them into space. I don't know what it is. It just never works. I mean, if you start with something like Event Horizon, which was essentially a horror series set out in space to begin with, or the Alien movies, It seems to work, but if you take something like Leprechaun in space, put it in space, or Critters, put it in space for the majority of the film, Hellraiser 4 in space, even though that was called Hellraiser Bloodlines, but it was still in space, so that counts. Jason X, a.k.a. Jason Voorhees, in space. You get the...
the upcoming Machete Kills in space.
Machete Kills in space.
Or the ever-popular series Pigs in space.
Mm.
What? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, we all know.
Or how about...
I don't know, that Sylvia seems very doubtful.
Or how about the... a Mel Brooks idea. We're Jews in space, flying around protecting the Jewish race.
So, yes, let's go from space into something completely different genre altogether, along with horror. Let's talk about the other questionable film that Sylvie had to sit through.
Yeah. Oh my god, because I don't know that many vampire films. Like, I know Vampire in Brooklyn, and I knew Twilight. I think those are, like, the only ones I could think of off the top of my head that I'd seen. Yeah. And I wasn't going to do Twilight. No, I was going to spare you guys. So I didn't do Twilight. Don't worry. Don't worry. Breathe a sigh of relief. There. So, Mike and I had been talking, and I originally had something else in mind, but then I'm like, you know, I want to try something different. Mm-hmm. I'll try a random film. So I had a few, like, free films that you could download digitally from, I guess, my library account. So there were four films.
Mm-hmm.
And I chose the one that sounded, I guess, the most interesting. I don't know if I made the right decision or not. Okay, so just a little back history of it. The movie was originally called Dead West. It was originally shown in 2010 at the Tucson Film Music Festival in Arizona, so it was like a film fest entry. The movie wasn't actually released on DVD until last year, 2013. By then, they had changed the name to kind of piggyback off the quote-unquote success of Cowboys versus Aliens. So this movie is called Cowboys versus Vampires, or Cowboys and Vampires. Or if you want to get technical, The Rise of the Horror Genre and the Fall of the Western. So this was bad. This was like, I'm hesitant to say, but it was like the room quality bad. It was borderline, it was atrocious. I think, I'm assuming Mike saw the trailer. Like the quality of the production. You look at it, and it looks like early 2000, like, TV series. It's just not good at all. And the plot's no better. It's like, there's this dude called Johnny Dust, and he's like a washed-up, Western actor. So he's relegated to doing, like, cheapo car commercials and being, like, a player, a stuntman at, like, an amusement park. So he's at this amusement park that used to be where they shot Western films. And he's there and he's, just making little money, trying to make ends meet until he can get his next big thing. So then this big bad, like, nameless corporation comes in. It's like, nope, we're going to buy you up. You guys aren't making money. You're just bringing in old people. So we're going to take the Western theme. We're going to strip it. We're going to make it a horror theme, or like a monster theme. Call it Ghost Town. We're going to bring in the young blood, the young money. We're doing this. So they repurpose the whole park so that it's called Ghost Town. And so everyone has to, like, audition and do, like, these new things where they're going to be, instead of being, like, in a Western, they're going to be, like, in a monster movie. Notice I haven't said anything about vampires yet. So it's still kind of like that Western theme. So 40 minutes in, this is like almost a two-hour movie. It feels like an eternity, but 40 minutes in, there's this sort of, there's this cave that they have an attraction. It's like a cave, like Minecraft mine ride, and it never works. So they use this cave, they repurpose the cave for the purposes of the for the purposes of Ghost Town. And so they go in and like, oh, there's this mysterious urn here that wasn't here when we originally, you know, came in here. And then the owner of the corporation, I think his name is Stanberg, he's like, no, it's fine, it's good, let's use it. And then the guy's working there's like, no, dude, it's like locked and spooky, so you know you're not supposed to be touching that. So he's like, screw you. So he touches it anyway. And then, like, all these... I can't even really describe what happens. It's just, like, he opens the urn, and basically anyone who comes in contact with the urn gets possessed. So the workers get possessed. I'm assuming Stanberg either is possessed or he wanted people to get possessed. I don't even know how he knew about the urn. And then just as a side note... Again, another contrived romance. There's a bit of a love triangle going on between Johnny Dust, like the main protagonist, and this hot Latino chick named Gloria, and his bitchy ex-wife with her daughter and stuff. So there's kind of this love triangle going on where she kicked him out, and they don't ever really establish why she kicked him out, but she still loves him, but she's still like, you know, you're a loser, you don't make money, like you're a bum. I kicked, like, she said, I kicked you, like, she's like, why did you leave? He's like, because you kicked me out, and they never really established that, so it's kind of a weird sort of power struggle. But anyway, so the young Latino chick, she works with Johnny as, like, opposite him, and somehow, like, because she gets nosy, and she goes in the cave to see what's going on, somehow the big spooky, like, ethereal thing gets her. And so again, 40 minutes into the movie, finally we see a vampire. She suddenly becomes a vampire. They don't explain how it happens. It just like, it gets sucked in her and she gets all veiny. And so she's possessed for like the remainder of the film. Yeah. And so, you know, they're rehearsing and she's, it's weird. It's like they repurposed the ghost town so that Johnny Dust is supposed to be the hero that saves the day. And ironically, that's pretty much what happens because suddenly everyone starts getting possessed and he's got to, like, save his friend and do this and that. And it's just, I mean, there's some redeeming qualities to it, like very, because it drags for most of the film. But the last 10 minutes, literally all hell breaks loose. I don't know if you guys are going to see this movie, but like it sort of like slumbers along. And then they get to the scene where the people, like, it's opening day at the place and families are going in the cave and stuff. So they have this like family with like two like 10-year-old boys and like a bunch of teenagers. In the last 10 minutes, all these like ghouls and zombie crap comes out of the cave and starts killing everyone. They kill the mom, they kill the dad, they kill the kids, they kill the teenager, they kill everybody. There's blood flying everywhere. And then yay, they just start attacking. Yeah, it's freaking insane. And it just like, the only redeeming quality I could say about the movie is that it does something kind of interesting where like throughout the film, we see this washed up Johnny Dust. He's conducting like almost like a radio interview. So he's like sitting down and having like a one-on-one with some woman you can't see off screen, and they're talking. And so it seems kind of lame. It's like, oh, you know, this washed up guy talking about things. So it kind of throws you off on how the movie ends. Basically, I don't even remember how it happens, but like Johnny like blows up all of Ghost Town. And it ends with him, like, running out of the cave, and he's on fire, and it just, like, the whole place burns up. It goes from, like, Tucson, Arizona to Waco, Texas. Excuse the reference there. But it's just, like, a big, like, flame ball afterwards. So it ends, basically, with everyone just looking at Johnny. He's, like, all burnt, like, to the ninth degree. And I think he, like, dies in the bed. So it's interesting. Well,
are you still paying attention to the movie at this point?
I don't know. I was kind of like catatonic at that point. I was totally, it was just bad. Like I'd like to think he died, Because if I was in the movie, I'd want to be put out of my misery, too. So,
you were like, I'm just sitting here watching this and thinking, yes, death would make a nice, sweet release.
But, like, this movie, Cowboys and Aliens, has as much to do with... Cowboys, yes, I messed up. Cowboys and Vampires has as much to do with vampires as Monsters and Aliens have to do with werewolves. Like, it's like, there's, like, just a little sprinkling of it. And the rest of it is just bullshit. Just bad acting and recycled footage and just bullshit. It's don't ever watch it. If you ever hear of it, don't look at it. Look the other way.
Well, now that I've heard of it, I'll stay away from it.
Today's lesson is vampire movies and main characters named Johnny really don't mix.
They do not. They do not.
They really don't. It's just, it sounds confusing and dumb, honestly. It's like, you could have just stick to a simple concept. It's just cowboys, it's just aliens, go out and have fun, but...
Oh, you said it too.
Why do you have to make a plot when you obviously cannot freaking write?
I mean, just listening to what you said there, again, vampire movie theory, a good vampire movie bends the rules. This movie apparently breaks the rules.
And pukes on it.
And pukes on it.
It breaks the rules of filmmaking.
And then...
It breaks the rules of logic.
Defecates on it and just spreads his butt cheeks and just, like, sits on it and just... I don't know.
Yep, and then rakes it all over the front yard.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah, it blows out of the water. It just, honestly, I think it blows directly 3,000 out of the water.
It's bad, man. It's set up like a TV movie. Like, originally I'm thinking, is this a TV movie? But it can't be, because they're saying fuck and they're swearing like it's a horror movie. Like, it's pretty mature. But it doesn't look like, I don't know. It's almost like Food Fight, right? Or like Food Fight was made like in 2000. Ooh. It's that kind of quality, except like live action and with vampires.
It's an indie film. Oh, God.
How can you go with the same caliber as Food Fight?
It's the Food Fight of indie films.
That's what Jesus! That sounds brutal.
There you go. That's the best
way I'm looking at the... I'm looking at the front cover of this thing right now.
Yeah.
I mean, how can you look at this and expect to have a good vampire movie come out of it?
I expect a porno coming out of that.
It gets very close to that. Yeah. There is a scene where the two, him and her, they're sitting and they're doing that sort of typical like movie banter that they would do before they start kissing, and then it becomes like, you know, they're in bed, like it's basically that same scene without the intimate like softcore porn going on. Like, honest to God, there must be like a director's cut out there.
Did the guy pull a Tommy Wiseau and just do it on her belly button?
Then later on, he instead of humping the sash, he humps a saddle, you know.
What?
Oh my God.
That's the thing about the room that I'm surprised nobody picks up on. While he's throwing a fit over his girlfriend, he's humping a sash. I watched the movie.
Oh my God.
I need to recheck that.
I think I blocked
he's
it
like,
out of my
head. Oh, why? Why you do this to me?
You understand me. You understand me more than Lisa.
Oh, God. Tearing me apart. Cut it out.
Yeah, and upon further inspection of this front cover, you know, you look at stuff like his vest, and you're just like, that's way too clean. I mean, this looks like...
Yeah, his name's Johnny Dust. You'd think it'd be a little...
Dusty.
You think he'd have some dust, right? Well, no.
He looks like he takes a shower.
It looks like... his clothing has this sort of community theater level of cleanliness to it.
This is the finest suit that you can get at Podomania.
What do you expect from a guy who can't even spell his name right? It's Jason Wade, and he spells it Jason with an E. So you already know you're in for some
dark
deliberate. Oh my god.
At least he wasn't called Jason X.
God, okay.
That's a sequel.
Let's just move on from this bad movie and talk about the last film of the podcast. And we come back to James for the final round, and it's a sequel of all things, which is an odd thing, which, considering the original film, I'm really curious what you think about the sequel, James. Tell us what the sequel is.
Here we're talking about Blade 2.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me get this straight right off the bat. I know that typically you're supposed to start off with the first film. The first film is always supposed to be the best in the franchise. I think this one might be the most memorable of the franchise, for me at least. Because it had the directorial touches of Mr. Guillermo del Toro.
Yeah, back when his popularity boomed with Pan's Labyrinth. My God.
Yeah, before Pan's Labyrinth. Even.
Well, like either or. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
I wanted to mention this one because, whereas I felt like the first Blade movie, it set up the rules, it set up the story, it sets everything up. Here you have a movie that's an idea that's very easy to follow, very very basic. A guy who's half vampire, with all the skills of being a vampire and none of the weaknesses, being pitted against, of course, vampires. And it was definitely a fun movie, but Guillermo del Toro comes along, and like any good vampire movie does, bends the rules. How does this happen this time? Well, and the first movie already bent the rules, but because you have to set up your own set of rules when you're dealing with a unique creature such as a half vampire. This is a guy that takes medication to deal with his bloodthirst problems. In Blade 2, the bending of the rules is mainly with the fact that instead of the enemies being vampires this time, Blade has to team up with vampires and face an even deadlier enemy. Reapers.
Oh, dear Lord.
And you thought Angelica Houston was some nightmare fuel? Well, check this out.
Oh boy.
Warning.
No. Warning.
Not safe. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Whoa! Jeez! Whoa!
That's a looker.
Oh, holy crap, did they blend in some Resident Evil crap?
His mouth is a Cthulhu.
What the fridge did the Umbrella Corporation do to that guy?
This is what a vampire looks like, evolved. The sensitivities of Mr. Guillermo del Toro, ladies and gentlemen, right here on A Vampire.
There's only one thing I could say to this guy.
Mm-hmm.
Do you kiss your mother with that mouth?
It's like mouth period, for God's sake.
Jeez.
I wonder if this guy works giving ear piercings. You think?
Ear piercings? He'll give you piercings where, like, you didn't even know you could have piercings for.
Yeah. And this is the type of uniqueness. This seems like the type of monster design, though, that Guillermo del Toro would later be known for in other movies like Pan's Labyrinth, where everything's, ew, inside out. Kind of. You're tired of looking at it?
I just turned it off.
I can't. I'm mesmerized. It's horrifying, but I can't look away. It's just...
And I also want to bring up another point. This is obviously the creature during attack mode. I couldn't find a good picture of a Reaper just looking normal.
Like in defense mode, pretty much.
Like just like someone who might be talking. And instead, I'm coming across pictures like that, and models like this. Eat your heart out, creepy face, Jim Carrey mask.
Oh my god! Jeez.
Let's see this. Ugh, do what not is want. This? His is tongue looks a... like a flower.
Yeah, I was about to say, is that a flower?
Gotta keep it fragrant and fresh, right? All that blood, you need something to dispel the aroma of rotting flesh.
So imagine this creature, though, without this mouth. What you have is, like I was saying before, the vampire with the more rat-like features, a.k.a. the Nosferatu.
Very true.
And this is where I think, again, the heritage of Nosferatu is sort of transcended its own boundaries. This is the ancestor of the Nosferatu, and it's kind of creepier.
Yeah, pretty damn scary.
Yeah.
More nightmares for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So what do you guys want to eat after this?
Cheeseburger.
Tongue.
Ice cream?
Can you imagine this guy licking an ice cream cone?
Oh my gosh.
Thank you for the triple soup. I wonder if he's also related to the cone heads. Seriously, we should get Matt back on. We should get Morgan back at some point and ask him to be like, "Is this a relation? In any relation to the Coneheads?" Open wide.
Yep.
Yeesh, dude. That'd be crazy.
Yeah. All in all, Blade 2, it did have a little bit of a cheesier story compared to the first one. I mean, they bring back Kris Kristofferson's character from the first film only for the sole purpose of bringing him back, which I still found kind of unbelievable because he shot himself in the middle of the previous film.
Well, then.
And the vampires bring him back to life because they want him as bait for Blade. So... they bait Blade in the first 5 minutes of the movie, and it kind of fails, and he gets back his Kris Kristofferson. So, first 10 minutes of the movie are a little bit weak on the ideas, but all in all, I like this movie a little bit more because I think it's a lot scarier. I think it has a lot more style to it. I just like the style better.
Paul, it's just three words for you.
Mm-hmm.
Guillermo del Toro.
Yes.
Yep.
I look forward to his interpretation of Pinocchio.
Yep. He's doing a darker, freakier version of Pinocchio. Hold on. I know
the Disney version's pretty dark as it is. That's going to be pretty.
Wait a minute.
F'd
oh boy.
Up.
Oh boy.
Yep.
I need
He's
to
doing
show
a
you...
stop motion Pinocchio.
But the art style.
Hold on.
Let me show you
that,
the art
man.
Style he's going to do.
God.
Where for art thou?
Am I going to be traumatized? Is my childhood going to be raped here? Just give me a heads up here.
Oh
my god.
Oh, I don't know. Okay, yeah. This article has the art style that will be featured. And apparently it'll be made by Jim Henson Company.
Oh god. Then I have to see it, I guess.
So yeah. What do you think?
Long as they have a wooden reaper puppet in there,
Gris
Grimley, I'm good.
Pretty much taking the art style of Gris Grimley.
Gris Grimley.
Yeah, I just put in the cover, so like.
That's nightmare fuel, man.
So imagine a stop motion film. Like that.
Oh my
it's
gosh.
Like Tim Burton on acid. Then they're
There's a lot of there's a lot of Tim Burton in there.
It's like the gray matter of Burton, Selleck, and Neil Gaiman just sort of had mind sex together.
An orgy, just a three-way.
Yeah, pretty much.
An orgy. Yeah. An orgy of gray matters between
and came
three
out
creative
this
geniuses.
Thing. And by the
that
way,
that would explain
before...
why he has the caterpillar's grin.
Yeah. By the way, before we end things off, I just want to do like, how about a little mention to, if you guys have any thoughts on the upcoming Dracula Untold.
I was just going there, Mr. Matthew. Thanks for reminding me.
Really? I swear to God, that was coincidence.
That's why I did this episode to begin with, because on Friday, we're going to have a new Dracula movie featuring the untold story of his origins.
Mm-hmm.
And based upon the trailer I've seen, it's... It could be a good movie. It sits in the past. It gives you character development of Dracula and how he becomes a vampire. And how he uses powers. How badass the powers are, you know? If you've seen the trailer, you see this big...
I actually saw a bit of the trailer. And if there's one thing I could say that it really looks familiar. It's familiar to the point that looking at the trailer, I was expecting to hear. No?
Dracula?
What I'm trying to say is that it really sounds a lot like the Maleficent.
No.
Because, like, you got the origin story.
No.
The
Notorious.
Yes!
You don't compare it to that.
It sounds a lot like... I mean, it's going to be the origin story.
It's an origin story. There's a lot of origin story movies out
Wait,
there.
Well,
you
I'm
don't...
sure that Dracula Untold is not going to have three dumbass fairies.
Is not the backstory for Dracula just, like, this backstory of Vlad the Impaler? So why don't they just do a story like that?
No. This is going to be Dracula the Vampire.
No, it has nothing to do with
not the real Dracula.
Check again. The the plot of the film does say that it involves the historical figure of Vlad Tepes, also known as Vlad the Impaler.
Oh, snap.
Oh.
But they are going to make him a Dracula.
He's going to be a Dracula.
This guy, historically, from what I understand, he was known as Vlad the Impaler because
likes to use the impale torture.
Yeah.
Yes.
He had a head on a pike.
Yeah.
And he was also a member of the House of Draculesti.
Word up.
Okay, so there's the connection. I was just about to say I didn't think that there was much of a connection.
It pays very much homage to the original history, and if you saw the if you saw a Universal logo, I think it's being made by Universal, I believe.
Yeah, it's Universal and Legendary Pictures.
Yeah, if you look at the Universal logo, it's like the iconic classic Universal Monster Studio logo, actually. Mm-hmm. They turn it into black and white, and then it's all nostalgic.
Universal is actually having a recurring theme. They are actually going to bring back, like, the Universal monsters.
That's what I heard. They're doing, like, a cinematic universe of these classic Universal monsters.
Like, they're gonna make The Mummy, but not, like, the Brendan Fraser version.
I try to give them their own films first, and maybe, like, the Marvel cinematic universe, bring them all together in one film. Frick.
And the Marvel universe?
So there's going to be like a Swamp Thing Untold and stuff? Is that Universal?
Eventually they're going to get to the point where they need to remake Monster Squad.
But what I'm trying to say with Dracula Untold is that I feel like they might go... I felt like they might go into the Maleficent route where they explain the story of Dracula and how he came to be, but they're going to make him a good guy anyways.
Yeah.
I think you can tell by the trailer it kind of does, because it does have like a family connection to it. Because I believe I'm not gonna spoil anything because it's in the trailer, you can see it yourself. Basically, he's in this war and something happens, his family's endangered, he must go to this high point somewhere, meet somebody. Oh, hey, he's a overlord of some sort. Oh, he's a vampire. Oh, bite him. Yes, okay, he's a vampire now. Oh, look at got these super-duper vampire powers where you can take all the bats of the world and combine it and make it like a fist and go boom onto the ground with the...
What?
It's like an action... There's an image in the trailer where there's a bunch of bats and they form into a fist and they go punch to the ground.
Oh my god.
It looks so goofy, but it looks so badass at the same time.
That's like that beehive thing where you attack a beehive in a cartoon and all the bees come together and they're like,
yes. I don't know. It could be an interesting film, and who knows, it might... I don't know. Actually, here's another question I want to pose. Are vampires overrated?
It depends which vampire you're talking about. Because, the sexy vampire we all know, that's still going around today, like with shows like Vampire Diaries or True Blood and stuff like that. But then again, we are seeing a bit of a comeback of the classic vampire we all know, rather be depicted in a more goofier fashion, like Adam Sandler in Hotel Transylvania, or in a more serious manner, like in the upcoming Dracula Untold. So, it's still a popular thing. Rather, if it is overrated or something like that, I'm not sure. But the subject of vampires has definitely brought up. And let me tell you, at least now they're being shined in a better light than during the Twilight days. I mean, seriously, even, like... I remember, like, during the
during the hype, during the big hype of Twilight, like I was actually missing the day. I actually missed those days of like I want to suck your blood, bleh.
Suck your blood, children of the night. So yeah, this is the end of the episode. Yes, vampires will still be going around and going around and going around until we all die. It's a never-ending monster that will continue to haunt our dreams. So the next episode. I told Sylvie the upcoming episode. You guys are left out in the dust.
Well, it's still going to be in the month of October. Is there going to be two more episodes in October or just this next one?
Just one more, because that's all they can fill.
I'm going to say zombies.
No.
Werewolves?
Got it.
Oh, wow, dude. Well, what do you know? Not bad.
James, wow. Bam.
Oh, wow, I was lucky.
It's Wanda in Living Color. What is what?
It's a nice cap off to the whole vampire theme. You can watch it afterwards. It's okay.
Okay. Gotcha. Yes, werewolves. We've been touching another universal monster of the past.
At least Jim Carrey's still being Jim Carrey, unlike Eddie Murphy.
Actually, besides the Living Color appearance, as you might watch, he was in a vampire film called Once Bitten.
Really?
Mm-hmm. If you want to see Jim Carrey as a vampire, you check out Once Bitten. It was his first leading role, I believe.
It was one of his first leading roles.
Yeah.
In a Hollywood movie.
Yes, so if you're curious about... If you didn't think Eddie Murphy was a good vampire, or you wanted to see another comedian get a little vampire-ish, check out Jim Carrey's in Once Bitten. But, yes, werewolves.
Oh my god, it's Jamie Foxx.
In drag! That's a true horror story.
Why couldn't this be Vampire in Brooklyn?
That would have been a better plot, I think. Just stretch that short out.
Oh my god.
This is an Oscar winner you're looking at. An Oscar nominee and an Oscar winner. Soak that in right now, please.
So yes, Carrie... Watch out for the full moon, because there'll be werewolves on the loose next time on Cinema Royale.
Guess I'll have to rewatch Teen Wolf.
Of course, the classic Teen Wolf.
I don't know any werewolves. That's weird.
I'll try my best to find werewolf stuff.
Oh, there's plenty of films you can cover, maybe... couple of TV films, you know, maybe Scooby-Doo and the Reluctant Werewolf.
Damn you, Mike. I wish you would have picked witches. I would have been all over witches. Werewolves, not so much.
Team werewolf over team vampire.
But werewolves are so much fluffier.
And they're friendly, too. You can pet them. It's a good boy.
They lick their crotch and stuff. They're not very sanitary.
How would you know?
I plead the fifth on that.
Whoa!
I'm Mike Mixtape, and I'm gonna howl over here now. Good night.
Good night.
Night night.
Hi.
Don't let the vampires bite.
Everybody do your best 30 days of night face.